Welcome back to segment three of show 15. So lightning round, what's the first question?
All right, so tell me, Ash, is TV dead?
I'm gonna be sitting on a panel at Digital Hollywood this week where we're gonna be talking more and more about that. No, TV is not dead. TV did more revenue than ever last year. TV still has the best programming. TV carries news and sports, et cetera, et cetera. TV's not dead. I just think that in 10 years, the companies that are the Viacoms, the News Corps, the NBCs, those companies will face to various degrees some of the same things that print and music companies went through. But overall, the same way that the advent of cable made total television consumption and advertising bigger, I do think, though, that overall, the overall consumption of content will just increase. Because now, if I don't have time to watch television, pretty soon I will be able to watch it on demand on a tablet. And the reason for that is that the gatekeepers like Comcast and Verizon are going to keep pushing the envelope to offer more to users because they control distribution and they want to offer more. Question number two. So you always think about, oh my God, if you embrace technology, you're going to basically survive.
Yeah, the early adopter theory.
The early adopter. But yet in practice, it's almost the opposite, case in point. The San Jose Mercury News, they adopted newspaper. They adopted the internet really, really early, and they almost got crushed more than anyone else. So why didn't the Mercury News become this amazing model of embracing the latest, shiniest gadget?
I haven't dived into the Mercury News case study deeply, but I think what really killed newspapers early off, whether they were early adopters or not, was a complete lack of ad targeting. To a big degree, the technology wasn't really there yet, but I think what they did wrong is they just tried to apply their print ad sales model to online, just sell out some real estate, then they found out there's only so much people are willing to pay for an impression, and then they started, as a result, they see their website is not making very much money, they treated it as this bastard redheaded stepchild, and they don't invest in doing more things. But really what it came down to is lack of ad targeting. With good ad targeting, they could have diversified more, mixed up impressions with CPA, with CPC, depending on who the user is, and they probably could have done a little bit more symbiotic editorial. Now, I realize newspapers are supposed to provide reporting and be objective, but like, let's face it, their arts and life section, their auto section, like these are sections of the newspaper that can actually drive a lot of page views, and they have a little bit more flexibility in terms of like the kind of editorial they deliver. So mostly ad targeting, but because of the ad targeting, they didn't invest in proper digital strategy because they didn't see a return.
Okay, I'm not gonna chime on. I am gonna say this, on an upcoming show, we're gonna talk about Craigslist, the impact on newspapers. How much of it is myth, how much of it is fear-mongering, FUD, and how much of it is actually legitimately what Facebook did to newspapers, okay? So, little mental note. Next question.
All right, so Mark Pincus did something interesting this week, Ash. Do you think he was unethical for trying to take away stock from his early employees?
So Mark Pincus is the CEO of Zynga, one of the hottest companies out there. Mark Pincus has already the unfortunate reality that there was a video of him like a couple years ago that came out about how much he talked about what unethical things he did to get revenue by basically, violating users' rights and all that. And it was very embarrassing to him. So Mark Pincus, that is context, that he has a track record of really pushing the envelope. But you know what? VCs and Wall Street love that kind of CEO. They love the kind of CEO who's cutthroat, who's gonna do what's best for himself and his company and his shareholders and could care less about, how things look. But to be fair here, there's what the market thought happened, which was Mark Pincus telling his employees, we're gonna take stock away from you because we wanna give it to new employees and we don't wanna dilute, I don't wanna dilute as a CEO or the investors don't wanna dilute. That's really unfair and shocking or whatnot. But what he actually said was, there are some employees who have not vested all their stock. Let's say you have stock that you earn over a four-year period, you've been with Zynga for 2 years. Or, the remaining 2 years of unvested stock, you should give some of that back because you're not performing the way we thought you were. This is a very murky area. It's like lawyers go crazy, right? So as much as what he's doing is unfair in the eyes of many, and I would never personally do it, it's not what was initially reported in the media, because nowadays people want to be the first to jump on a story and not report the facts. That is not cool. I'm going to just say, listen, Mark Pincus is Mark Pincus. That's how he is. It shouldn't surprise you. And VC-backed companies don't really care about anyone but the investors who put in the money. Not the shareholders who might have stock as employees and all that, but the guys who put the money. To me, when I started WatchMojo, and this is like naive, idealistic, stupid, you know, innocent Ash here, but I was like, you know, I'd like to start a company where I can, you know, be a certain way with clients and employees. And you know what? That's, I think, naive and you know, stupid, basically. That's the real world. What Mark Pincus is doing just got out. Stuff like that, unfortunately, happens at more or less every venture-backed companies. It's just the reality.
Well, you're still not answering the question. Just because it happens and just because it makes sense from a business investment side, is it ethical or not?
Is it ethical? It's, life's unfair. I don't think it's ethical. I don't share Mark Pincus's moral compass. But Mark Pincus is worth, on paper, let's say $5 billion. I'm worth $5, let's say. And I think it depends what is your objective in life. If it's purely to make money, like, you know, it's like there was a class I had in college. It was, what's the objective? What's the constraint? If you wake up in the morning and your objective is make the most money possible, let's say for me, it's like build something that has value. And the constraint is don't be a dick. You know, I could step on the neck of many people, clients, suppliers, employees, to get an extra $2 out of every transaction. I like to go with what Dick Parsons, former chairman of Time Warner, says, which was, when you negotiate, leave something on the table for the other party. If you always try to get every penny on the table, well, that other, your counterparty, won't want to deal with you down the road. So Mark Pincus, we live in a world, it's a capitalist world, VCs, markets, everybody rewards that kind of behavior implicitly and explicitly. It doesn't matter if it's unethical. That's the world we live in. VCs are conditioning entrepreneurs to be bastards. That's the world we live in. It's not about ethics. It's, that's the world we live in. So if you decide to play ball with VCs, that's the kind of stuff you have to do. You know, I wouldn't do it. Do I think Mark Pincus is an a-hole? I don't know him. Would I do that? No. What does that do to morale? Doesn't really help it. The profile of an employee that joins you when you're worth $20 billion is different than the employee that joins you when you got a piece of paper on a napkin. You should treat those employees differently. But again, I'm not anybody to tell Mark Pincus what to do.
Sounds like you're trying really hard not to offend him right now.
Here's what I will say. I would love it if Fred Wilson, who's the investor in Zynga, to chime in on that, but I'm pretty sure he won't either. It's a beautiful thing in life. You don't have to agree with people and, you know, did litigation ultimately help the music industry?
I think litigation screwed the music industry. Napster came out, MP3.com came out. They got sued. They got shut down. The people who are interested in this kind of technology said, okay, what were the legal terms of why, you know, Napster didn't get away with it? We'll just find another way of doing it. Current peer-to-peer technology. Now the music industry has no choice but to go after like single moms, which they've done to, you know, make an example.
But and at not the end to pick the day, them up, to sue their, you know. Anyway.
Yeah, well, that's it, you know, and you can't sue every consumer out there. So I think litigation ultimately screwed them. I think, you know, maybe they should have played ball with Sean Parker and actually jumped on that bag a lot earlier. They probably could have precluded the possibility of iTunes if they'd done so. Who's to say, you know? It's in the past and we'll never know, but yeah, I think litigation screwed them pretty hard.
Email of the week?
Email of the week, ooh, Baltimore. Not too many emails come from Baltimore. Ansel, is that how you pronounce it?
Ansel? Ansel, yeah.
Ansel from Baltimore.
I'm guessing, but yes.
I hope so. Sorry, Ansel. Do you need to be in New York or San Francisco or any major city to do a digital media or tech startup?
I actually went to college with an Ansel, but he wasn't from Baltimore. Do you need to be in New York or San Fran or LA or any major city to do a media or tech startup? I think you could start a company more or less everywhere, but to scale it, you do need to be in a big city. I don't care about what technology does and this and that. I'll give you a couple of examples. So we started the company in Montreal. It's a great city. It's great to start it. Lots of talent here. You know, you see everybody loving it, shouting, you know, shout outs to the city. But you know, like when Google and YouTube basically forked over $100 to $200 million to content producers, you know, there is merit if you are in their face and you run into the people who make those kind of decisions at the cocktail parties and the after party events and all that. And I think if you're not, you know, out of sight, out of mind, if you're not in front meeting people, running into people, stumbling into people, you do miss out on a lot of opportunities. But at the end of the day, I think the beautiful thing about the web is you should probably set up your company where you're going to find talent. You know, so for us, being in the media creative space, I think I lucked out, or I mean, I don't want to say it was part of the vision. I think I lucked out to be set up in Montreal. There's a lot of very creative people. If I would have been a tech company, you know, I think then, yeah, you might need to be. And now here's the irony. Even in tech, it's harder to hire in San Fran than it is, say, in Montreal, right? So times have changed. But I do think, though, that if you really want to build like a multi-billion dollar company, then you do need to be in like the center of capital and the center of your field. So New York or San Fran or LA. So you could set it up anywhere, but you do need to move very quickly.
Or at least have some kind of representation there.
Yep. All right. So that was this week's show number 15. And we'll be back next week, same time, same place.